I'm talking to you today from Donegal, very close to the border between the north and south of Ireland. And this border has once again been in the news this week as a consequence of Brexit and the implementation of the Northern Ireland Protocol. We have the so-called border down the Irish Sea, and this is causing some consternation, anger and confusion about how this border might work and how it threatens the constitution of the north of Ireland and the union. So the border continues to be ever present in our thoughts and in our imagination here. And I'm also here today to talk about Where Dove, which is a new work that I've made for this exhibition, which is also concerned with borders and our evolving relationship with borders. The work was conceived in 2019 after some discussion with Daniele DiLuigi and Anne Stewart, the two curators of the exhibition, we agreed that the overall or the broad thematic of the exhibition should be borders. This was at a time when Brexit hadn't yet been resolved and there was a degree of uncertainty as well. Right across Europe, but also particularly in Italy, in relation to migration from other parts of Europe and North Africa into Italy and other parts of Europe. And this was particularly, I suppose, exacerbated in light of the rise of populism and far-right governments in Italy and elsewhere in Europe. So that was the general context in which the exhibition took shape, and part of the context that allowed me to make this work. Where Dove is a two-screen video installation. So it uses the diptych form, which is one that I've used many times in the past, right through to the earliest black and white photographic works that I made in Derry and on the border between Derry and Donegal in the mid-1980s. So it's a format that allowed me to look at some of the ambiguities, some of the differences and some of the similarities between different places, and to investigate the language that is used to talk about these complex situations. So essentially this work has two characters, if I can call them that, who inhabit the same space, the same borderland, although they appear to be unaware of each other's presence, so they're kind of oblivious to each other, but they coexist somehow. The two characters in the work remain essentially ill-defined. We know very little about them, their backstory, and how they come to be in this place. So they both in some ways share a troubled relationship with this place. The young man describes himself as being in transition, moving between the past and the future. So he is essentially looking forward. The older man appears to be somehow caught in his past, unable to leave that behind and to move forward. So for him, the future is a very different proposition than it is for the younger man. One of the things that both characters talk about in the work is the prevalence of memory. And I suppose particularly the way in which memory is connected to trauma. So both characters, even though they're coming from very different experiences, have this connection with the past and their memories of the past. And again, this is something that has been present in quite a number of the works that I've made, that somehow attempt to deal with some of the unresolved business of the past, and particularly in connection with landscape and specific sites. And I suppose at some level, this haunting or this attempt to uncover the powerful and persistent presence of memory is something that that I experienced myself in childhood. I remember that there was a very brutal murder that took place very close to where I lived, and it was one of those events that actually shocked people. And I remember that this particular incident was one that people spoke about for a long time afterwards, and even today talk about it with a degree of shock and shame in some ways that this event happened. So anyway, as a 12-year-old, this was in 1972, I used to have to walk past the place where this murder took place. And I used to run past this place as quickly as I could because I was so terrified of seeing this figure in this place, that somehow the ghost of this person was still present. We get fleeting glimpses of the two men. Fleeting in the sense of bordering on the visible, that they're somehow practically not there. So in that sense, they have a relationship with the presence of a ghost or a specter that I've used in all works in the past, from Ghost Story to Buried. And in some ways that sense of the landscape holding some secrets from the past, that there is a sense of the landscape itself being embedded with this material, this unresolved material, that is still quite present in this work. Ultimately, the specifics of the border in Weir Dhowi is ill-defined. It's fragmentary in a way. And perhaps it's like many of our experiences of borders that we have never seen, that were not affected by their presence. It allows us to be somewhat detached from the experience of the people whose lives are caught up by the imposition of controls on their movement across borders. So I think ultimately the work is about empathy, that Even though we don't know the full story of these two people, we don't know the consequences of what happens next and of their actions. But I think the work asks us to look at them and to empathize with their predicament, and to in some ways understand that we ourselves could easily be caught in similar circumstances, that these certainties that we think are in our lives can change very quickly, and it's possible to find yourself in a whole set of unforeseen and unexpected circumstances that are out of your control, and that loss of control in our lives is often just very nearby. You know, that things can slip away and change extremely quickly in volatile political and economic circumstances.